Good morning.
Good morning.
It is cold out there.
What?
Well, but I have faith that I can survive the winter. So in your prayers, don't forget your pastor. Pray for him, okay? So friends, it is always a blessing to be at church every Sunday morning and express our feelings to God. One of the most important parts of our participation in worship is the possibility of sharing anything we have in our hearts with God. And knowing that everything we say and sing, and we do it together, right? Amen. It's a possibility to understand the feelings, the emotions, the thoughts, and try to connect all of these with the transforming presence of God. So that's how I see worship services. And this morning, we're gonna try something different, okay? So singing with us this morning, the boss, Giselle, my wife. So we have three new people with us this morning, and the plan is to have them permanently leading worship along with Joshua. So I'm thankful for the work that Joshua has been, well, I think the last 2 months you have been doing, preparing this music, finding the right people, and finally, here we are for this first day trying something new. So I want to say welcome to Pete and Dave, who'll be joining us with the music. And I hope that you enjoy, but also participate. Amen.
Good morning. We have some announcements. First of all, of course, it's a policy to wear a mask when you're singing. Also, the prayer cards and the narthex are not only for prayer concerns, but also to request a call or visit from our Pastor Marcelo. And along with our regular weekly activities in the bulletin, we have the Ad Council will be meeting Tuesday evening at 7 o'clock in Jane's room, so please let Jim Bronson know if you're not attending. And on Wednesday at 7 o'clock, also in Jane's room, there will be an SPRC meeting, and let Peter Sheffer know if you cannot attend. Marcelo has also asked me to let you know, as he started out, his office hours were Mondays and Tuesdays. But moving forward this week, he is going to start, with the exception of tomorrow, of course, as a holiday, he will be having his office hours on Mondays and Wednesdays, which makes it more convenient for him to connect up with the staff that he needs to. Now, I want to mention looking ahead and remind the church leadership that annual reports are due by the end of the month, and I think this year we particularly want to put together a nice booklet to give our new pastor an idea of how our year went and what each group was doing. And the other piece is, you're well aware that we're part of, I believe it's called the Thanksgiving Angels. The article was in the paper yesterday. gathering all the food for the food baskets that will go out into the community. And here at First Methodist, we are asked to supply the green beans. And I know we've already started, but just a reminder, when you're at the store, you may pick up an extra couple of cans or so. But our assignment for that is going to be green beans. Thank you.
Let us pray. God, we're thankful for this time together and for the blessing of being here with one another. We are thankful for our lives, families, jobs, but also we're thankful for your presence in our lives in a way that we can find meaning. We ask for your blessings upon us in a way that we can experience something new during this time together, as we worship together, as we sing and pray and reflect on your word. Thanks for this blessed opportunity. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
All right. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Amen. First scripture reading will be taken from Mark chapter 10, verses 17 through 31. Okay. As Jesus started on his way, a man ran up to him and fell on his knees before him. "Good teacher," he asked, "what must I do to inherit eternal life?" "Why do you call me good?" Jesus answered. "No one is good except God alone. You know the commandments. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony. You shall not defraud. Honor your mother and your father." "Teacher," he replied, "all these things I have kept since I was a boy." Jesus looked at him and loved him. "One thing you lack," he said. "Go, sell everything you have and give to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come and follow me." At this, the man's face fell. He went away sad because he had great wealth. Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, "How hard it is for the rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed at his words, but Jesus said again, "Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God." The disciples were amazed and said to each other, "Who then can be saved?" Jesus looked at them and said, "With man this is impossible, but not with God. All things are possible with God." And then Peter spoke up, "We have left everything to follow you." "Truly I tell you," Jesus replied, "no one has left home or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for me and the gospel will fail to receive 100 times as much in this present age, homes, brothers, sisters, mothers, children, and fields, along with persecution, and in the age to come, eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first." This is the word of the Lord.
Ungezongezilina se muva, no.
me again. Second scripture reading will come from Romans chapter 5, verses 1 through 5. Therefore, since we have been justified through faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through him, through whom we have gained access by faith into this grace in which we now stand, and we boast in the hope of the glory of God. Not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. This is the word of the Lord.
Amen. So I have a question for you. Do you understand religion? Do you understand the rules, the theology, the way how religion talks about life, relationships, and nature, and spirituality? The fact is, sometimes we don't. And especially those who are in church don't understand religion. And the reason is because we normally think that religion means denomination, a name, a institution. And I think that's one of the problems we have as religious people. And we try to convince others about religion, that our religion is the best one, is the right one. I know that we can say something different about language. I can say that Portuguese, it's beautiful and a better language than English. Thank you, Joshua. Thank you for your support.
It's easier for you.
Yeah. So how to understand religion? I think this verse, this chapter of Romans, helps us to connect the sense of what really means to be a religious person. And I like the way how Paul describes the faith, the grace, the connection with Christ, the ability of creating peace with God, and developing a sense of growth. So I see two components in this chapter. Number one, it's what he says in the beginning of this chapter, that we can have peace with God. But the connection between human beings and God to find this peace is Jesus Christ. And I like to say that Jesus is the hermeneutical key to understand the Bible, the values in the Bible, the will of God for us, and theology. So if I want to understand what religion really means, I just need to look at Jesus' life. The way how he lived his life. The way how he treated people. So that's one important component in this chapter. And it is a mistake to think that I need the church, the denomination, to connect with God. That's a mistake. But we need a community. And I think that's one of the things that Jesus started with his life and ministry. that we need to have others with us in this path, developing our spirituality. So Jesus is the center of this connection, this religion, this process of connecting and reconnecting with God. But there is another important component here, which is a process. Paul is saying that after realizing that Jesus is the connection between human beings and God, we have the chance to grow our faith. In my 17 years of experience as a licensed psychoanalyst, I can say that patients come to my office with the wrong motivation. People normally come to my office expecting to treat something, symptoms, mental conditions, but that's not the point of being in therapy. It's not about treating conditions or symptoms, but it is about resignifying the person. So when you understand that, you're able to deal with whatever you have in your life. So I like to use this metaphor in the religious context and say that when we receive Christ, not because we want to have this religion or that religion, it's not about right and wrong, but it is about developing a relationship with God through Christ in a way that we can resignify ourselves as human beings, as individuals. So it is a process. And Paul starts saying that the first step in this process is something weird. He says, see, too small. Yeah. Well, we need many things after 40, right? Well, he says in verse 3, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings. And let me tell you something about the word glory in the biblical Greek. It has many meanings. It's the same word for different meanings. So in Greek, you can say that glory means personal opinion. It also means value in something, but also means divine nature. So that's interesting to know that the word glory means personal opinion. So Paul is saying, in my understanding, that the first step in this growth process in our lives is to have a strong and personal opinion about sufferings. But note that before doing that, before creating the understanding, the right understanding about sufferings, we need to have peace with God through Christ. So sometimes we do not understand sufferings because we don't have the right connections with heavens. Sometimes we do not understand sufferings in life just because the glory we are using to understand our sufferings, it's not the strong personal opinion based on peace, and peace with God. So in this growing process, I need to decode the sufferings of my life. And I believe that's what religion is lacking nowadays. It's not offering the right response for the world's sufferings. We keep telling people about religious rules and liturgical needs instead of creating relationship, because what we see in the beginning of this chapter is that we can have peace with God through Christ. This is about creating relationship with Christ, to have peace with God. So it's personal. It's your relationship with God. It's not the pastor from the pulpit saying what you can do or what you cannot. But it is about each and every person opening the heart and saying, I want to have peace with God. I want to understand the meaning of my life, and I want to understand that through this transforming relationship. So when I do that, I'm able to decode sufferings. I'm able to create, to have, to envision glory in my sufferings. But he continues saying that we have another step. And the second step, it's perseverance. And I like to see perseverance as an acknowledgement process. Every step of the way, every step of my spiritual life, every step of my life, professional life, family life, I need to acknowledge that. I need to give names to my feelings, to my emotions. I need to understand the meaning of those in my life. I need to understand why it's important to be here Sunday morning. Because it is about relationship. It is about having peace with God. And it is about understanding the mediation that Jesus creates between human beings and the divine, so we can grow as individuals and also as a community. Acknowledging the good things and the bad things in my life is important. There is a law in thermodynamics that says energy can neither be created nor destroyed, only transformed, transferred, changed. This is about growth. And this is about the process that I'm sharing with you this morning. Every step after having peace with God through Christ, every step, sufferings, perseverance, and the others, is an opportunity to change ourselves, to transform ourselves. And what is the energy that we have in this process of growth? It's the work of the Holy Spirit. That's the energy we have. So what is your glory and the sufferings you have gone through? What is your strong personal opinion about the bad stuff and the good stuff in your life? And second, are you able to identify, to name, to understand what is happening inside of you? Some philosophers say that death, it's what gives life meaning. I'm not sure if this is a correct statement about death, but I can say this, this is a great statement to start thinking about the meaning of our lives. The next step then is character. And that's another interesting meaning in the biblical Greek, because it means engraving something. It's like the work of God within us in a way that all of the things that we don't need will be out of the way. But we need to do it. We need to open our minds and see the things I need to change, the things I need to transform. And Paul tells us that the end of this cycle, this process, is hope. But hope can only be generated if we go through this process. We all have issues. We all have challenges and problems in our lives. But here's two things we need to understand about spirituality. Number one, we all need to make this way of peace with God. We all need to have peace with Him. And the only way to do that is through Jesus Christ. And I'm not saying anything about the historical Jesus or the biblical Jesus, but I'm telling you about the spiritual Jesus, the Son of God, the one you can establish your own experience and relationship. I don't know about your life this morning. I don't know about your feelings. Whatever you have in your heart about religion and God and spirituality, but I know that if you open your heart in a way to understand that you can have peace with Him, in a way that you can identify the steps of this growth process, you can be a better person, a better father, better son and daughter. Please pray with me. Precious God, we're thankful for this morning. And we're thankful for the word we just shared. Thankful because we know the work we need is the work of your Holy Spirit. That this is not about denomination, but it is about relationship, it is about spirituality, and it is about understanding the process. We now pray for peace. Those in conflict with religion, spirituality, church, but we also pray that we can find a spiritual life that is meaningful, in a way that we can understand the sufferings, the steps of perseverance, to understand the things that need to be transformed in our characters so we can find hope. We pray for this church, for this community. We pray for each and everyone that is here listening to this message, and now praying. Fill our hearts with your grace and your peace. That's what we say and ask in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you.
Please join me in the Lord's Prayer. You're welcome to pray this prayer in another version or language. Let's do it together. Our Father in heaven, help us to honor your name. Come and set up your kingdom so that everyone on earth will obey you as you are obeyed in heaven. Give us our food for today. Forgive us for doing wrong as we forgive others. Keep us from being tempted and protect us from evil. Amen.
God graciously gives to us each day, and so let us graciously return our gifts as the ushers wait upon you to take the offering. God of the cosmos and God of every heartbeat, your work touches every corner of creation. Yet when times are hard, we wonder if you deserted us, and we become tight-fisted and fearful that sharing with others will leave us empty-handed. As we bring these gifts to your altar, give us the eyes to see and the hearts to know that you never desert us and never send us away in need. In the name of your Son, who came to remind us of your closeness and to give his life so that ours might be eternal. Amen.
The voice in the desert crying, preparing.
was hard to teach them how to play this song, you know? God, we are thankful for this morning. And we pray that the grace of Jesus Christ, the Son, the presence of the Holy Spirit, and the love of our God the Father be with us this morning and every single day. Amen. May God bless you. Have a great week, and I hope to see you next Sunday, 10 a.m.